Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. It was now the month of Rajab in the ninth year after Hijrah. Islam had brought peace to the land. The warring tribes and factions had ceased, and life finally had a sense of normality. The physical enemies that once oppressed the Muslims had all been dealt with. The mushrikeen and Jews were done. And the only real issue the Muslims had to deal with, apart from the munafiqeen, was the normal difficulties of life: drought, famine, and poverty. Just over 6 months had passed since Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken up permanent residence in Medina, when once again a new threat emerged. The near enemy had been defeated, but the far enemy was still for the most part untouched. The far enemy being the Romans and others like the Persians. And so it happened that the Roman army began amassing in their numbers near their border. And they had allies amongst certain tribes in the Hijaz who were Arab Christians, namely Judham, Lakhm, and the most prominent tribe, Ghassan. The army of the Kuffar had numbered about 40,000, and when the Nabataeans, their traders, came to Medina, they brought with them this news, saying that the Romans and their allies are preparing to attack the Muslims in Medina. When this news was taken to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum to inform all of the other Sahaba around to prepare themselves for jihad, because the Muslims would take the fight to them and not allow them to take a footstep into the lands of the Islamic State. The Battle of Tabook had so many specialities about it, miracles and what not. It was a day when Allah exposed the munafiqeen and made the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum shine brighter than the sun. It was a battle that made clear the distinction between Muslim and munafiq. It was a difficult period for the Muslims because the weather was exceptionally hot. It was a dry year and the crops were almost ready for harvesting. And the journey was to be quite long and hard. Plus, many of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum were poor and didn't have enough food to eat, let alone weapons and mounts. That is why this army came to be known as Jayshul Usra, the army of difficulty, because they rose up fi sa'atil usra, during that difficult hour, and proceeded for Ghazwatul Usra, that difficult battle. But despite all the difficulties, when the call of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went out, then the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum answered that call, which resulted in the Muslim army amounting to 30,000 soldiers. That's how fast the Islamic State had grown in those few months, that the army which was 12,000 6 months ago, now was almost thrice its size. Because of the large amount of the army and the amount of poverty that many of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum had, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called on the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum to give sadaqah for the army. Hazrat Umar radiyallahu anhu took half of everything he owned and brought it for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him what he had left for his family, he replied, "The same amount as what I had brought." Then Hazrat Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu came with what he had. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him what he had left behind for his family. And Hazrat Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu replied, "I have left behind Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam." In other words, he left not a single worldly possession behind. He gave all of his wealth, just like that, for the sake of Allah. Hazrat Umar radiyallahu anhu, he cried when he heard this and he said, "I will never be able to surpass you in anything." Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu showed his generosity once again. And with this army of 30,000, Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu personally kitted out 10,000 soldiers. A third of the army was completely paid for. The camels for them to ride, the weapons to use, the armor to wear, the cloth that's placed on the camel, even the string that is used to tie their water bags. Every single thing Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu provided. The other Sahaba radiyallahu anhum came with whatever they could. Some came with a few kgs of dates, and others didn't even have a handful of dates to give, so poor they were. Hazrat Ulba ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu was one of those poor Sahaba. He performed his salah at night and he cried in his dua saying, "Oh Allah, you have given the command of jihad and I desire to join, but I don't have any possessions to give in sadaqah. Oh Allah, I only have my honor to give. So I forgive everyone that had ever harmed me as my sadaqah." The next morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Hazrat Ulba radiyallahu anhu and told him that Allah has accepted your sadaqah. Hazrat Ulba radiallahu anhu was amongst the Sahaba, those seven Sahaba that were known as the Bakkaun, the criers in English. They came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to ask if there's any mount for them to be able to join the battle. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had nothing for them, so they returned home crying. But while returning home their separate ways, Allah sent three Sahaba radiallahu anhum their way. The first was Hazrat Yamin ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, and he asked the two Sahaba radiallahu anhum that he met up with what was wrong, and then explained to him their plight. So he took them home and gave them everything they needed. The next two Sahaba were met by Hazrat Abbas radiallahu anhu, and he provided for them. And lastly, Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu, once again, he provided for these last three. So all seven of these Sahaba who were so poor and didn't own a single possession, but they were sincere in their desire for jihad, Allah accepted it from them and they were now able to join the army of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Sahabiyat radiyallahu anhunna were no less in their generosity, and they gave everything they had, their jewelry, their musk and everything. It was freely removed and given without a second thought. The only ones that remained behind were the Munafiqeen once again, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul and others such as Al-Jadd ibn Qais, because he asked for permission to stay behind from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, saying that the Roman women were too much of a fitna for him. Him and others like him were given permission to stay behind because they were Munafiqeen. His son though, Hazrat Abdullah ibn al-Jadd radiyallahu anhu, he was a true Sahabi, a Badri companion no less, and he condemned his Munafiq father and proceeded to join Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There were only three Sahaba radiyallahu anhum that had delayed slightly before leaving, and thus by the time they left to join the army, it was a bit too late. But after their boycott, Allah had forgiven them, and we remember them for their honesty and truthfulness and their belief in Allah up until this very day. And so the army of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam set out on this long journey. In the initial stages, Hazrat Abu Dhar al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu was delayed because his camel was lame and hobbling. And when he saw that it wasn't likely to recover, Hazrat Abu Dhar radiyallahu anhu loaded all of his belongings onto his back and walked like that under the burning sun. The distance that the Muslims had traveled the first day was far, and so the army sat down to rest, and as they were resting, they saw a solitary silhouette of a man appearing on the horizon, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said wishing, "Let it be Abu Dhar." When the man got close enough to be seen, it turned out to be Hazrat Abu Dhar radiyallahu anhu after all, that had walked non-stop from Medina with his belongings on his back, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was immensely pleased and made dua for him. After 18 stops along the way, the Muslim army finally arrived at Tabuk, which is where the Romans were supposed to have been gathering. But the Muslims found no army there, as the Romans had second thoughts about the battle and thus abandoned their plans of attacking the Muslims. And so the Muslims began the long journey home once again. And thus, the Ghazwatu Tabuk came to an end. And it was this battle that opened the doors for the future conquests, such as the Futuhu Sham, the conquest of Sham, Iraq, Persia, and Africa, to name a few. This was the last battle that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam personally took part in, because the next year Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam left this worldly abode, having marched out 28 times in jihad fi sabilillah in the short space of 9 years in reality, not even the full 10 years that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in Medina. The spirit and love of jihad was firmly entrenched in the hearts of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. Thus, they kept the flag of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and jihad flying high as they spread Islam to all the corners of the world. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.